off to a great start.
I'm just wondering, who the hell turned down the volume on the headphones?
I don't know.
I had no idea. All right.
Just turn it all the way off.
Matt Ray, WMDX. Oh, I think the...
What? The Maxine
the Irish
people? Oh,
what? The Irish... What are the...
The leprechauns.
Were
what they've
the
been
studio.
In the works.
Oh,
yes.
The leprechauns yes. and the gremlins.
I should remember the leprechauns. I watched Darby O'Gill and the Little People last night.
Yeah? You watched... Really?
What an incredible movie. Just a fantastic... Look, if I ever recommended a movie...
Yeah.
And said it was a perfect movie. That would be the movie.
What's the movie name again?
It's Darby O'Gill and the Little People.
Okay.
And it's an very early Disney film. And original Irish actors. It is just one of the most fun films to watch. And the special effects are just fantastic.
Really?
The way they made the leprechauns. It's a feat all unto itself.
Fantastic.
You really have to check this out. In fact, my son is 25 now. He invited his friends over to watch this this movie, and everybody loved it. It's just gorgeous. And there's a Blu-ray out on it, DVDs as well. But they have how it was made on that DVD, and it is just fantastic, all the special effects. Back then, they didn't have much in terms of special effects.
I've never heard of this. It's got an unusual name.
Darby O'Gill.
Darby O'Gill.
And the Little People.
Okay. All right.
And Sean Connery, one of his first acting jobs was in that movie. He was the lead romantic character.
Okay.
We'll
have to look that one up.
And the Banshee. Okay. Oh, the Banshee.
The Banshee?
Yes, the Banshee. What a fantastic looking Banshee. One of the best special effects ghosts you'll ever look at. Apparitions. It's fantastic. All right.
Okay, good to know. Anyway, good morning. It's the John and Gordy Show for a Monday.
Yeah.
Mad Radio 92.7.
The standard intro.
WMDX. We're happy to be here on a bright and sunny Monday morning. Oh, wait a minute. The sun's not up yet.
Is it going to be sunny?
It's going to be partly sunny. Yeah.
Hey, no frost on the car windows.
No
either.
Frost. But it is cold. 23 degrees this morning. We get up to about 37 or so today.
It goes to show how poor we are, right?
What do you mean?
We don't park our cars indoors.
No.
We're still parking it outside.
Right.
So we're worried about frost in the car windows.
Well,
other folks out there park in a garage, nice warm garage, insulated.
I have a garage, but
I
don't use it. I've got a lot of stuff stored in there. I can fit my car in there.
Okay.
But I just usually leave it outside just because it's easier and faster.
Well, that's good. It's good.
Jump in the car and get going.
You don't have to rent a storage facility at all.
You've got
a garage for
A garage, yeah.
Everybody does that.
You don't have a garage.
They store enough stuff that they can't even park their car in the garage.
Yeah.
All right.
Yeah. Anyway, happy day after St. Patrick's Day. We enjoyed a lot of fun yesterday afternoon.
Completely burned out. And I've just, what an exciting time at
the High Noon Saloon.
Yes.
Yeah, it was good. Rocker was there and three bands.
Yeah.
Super Tanker, Iron Plow, and what's the last one?
Cindy Set My Hair on Fire.
I was going to say Nancy Set My Pants on Fire. I was close, but I knew I was in the ballpark. Anyway,
Now, I had a deja vu.
Yeah, did you?
When we were up on stage.
Right.
And I asked the guy, I said, well, let's find out for everybody how they came up with the name.
Yeah.
Cindy Set My Hair on Fire. Right.
Right, and they all just kind of looked at you.
They
like,
all looked
why
at me like, what are you guys doing?
Why are you asking us a question?
leave us alone. We're trying to play here.
Yeah, we're just about to start.
But the guy looked at me, and then he pulled off his sock hat. Or baseball hat, whatever it was, and he had a bald head, and he says, "This is why."
Okay,
and he's bald, and he burned his hair off. I guess
that's sad.
Yeah,
okay.
Yeah.
It seemed like
that answer. I had gotten that answer before, and that's my deja vu moment.
Oh, well, maybe so. I don't think we asked anybody before that, but
no joke. Something similar to that happened to my grandma.
Really,
she. She always wore a lot of hairspray, and one time she and my grandpa were burning brush in their backyard. And my grandpa turned around and he heard this big whoosh, and he turned back to look at my grandma, and her hair was on fire.
Wow. Oh no. She okay?
Oh yeah, she was okay. Fine. It was just her hair, but we could, just funny hair. Story.
We could it sounds like a Christmas song.
It does.
Grandma's yeah. Grandma's got her hair on fire.
Okay, let's see. What is the date today? Is
it the 18th?
Hey, let's check out the National Day calendar for today. What day? You got some music there, Sam? Hit it. All right. What day is it or isn't it?
Is there a fake day in this one?
Is there? Where you're going to find out.
Okay.
Is it Biodiesel Day or Sloppy Joe Day? Is it Lacey Oatmeal Cookie Day? Is it Awkward Moments Day? Supreme Sacrifice Day? Or National Newspaper and Magazine Day? Which one of those does not belong? Which of those is
the
not?
The Girl Scout cookie thing.
I didn't say.
Squiggly cookies.
That wasn't even an option.
That wasn't a choice. But Lacey Oatmeal Cookie
Lacey
Day?
Oatmeal
is that what you?
Cookie Day.
No, that's an actual day today. So you are wrong.
Well, I can't wait to find out what that is.
Sam? You already know.
Yeah, I do know. Okay, it's not National Newspaper and Magazine Day.
That's right.
Oh, that
newspapers and magazines
choice.
Actually don't really all exist right. That much anymore.
No.
Especially newspapers. Sad, but true.
Well, it is sad.
So let's find out about National Biodiesel Day. Each year, the National
What was the fake day?
The newspaper one.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. National yeah. Newspaper
right,
Day.
That.
That was the...
Okay. I didn't know you said that was the fake day.
I did. I said it kind of quickly, so, you know, you want me to slow down?
Could you?
Have I had too much coffee already?
I'm still recovering from yesterday. Yeah,
it was a long day, a long afternoon there. It was great, though. It was a great crowd.
Yeah.
Good to see everybody in High Noon Saloon. What a place.
There was a guy there. He met us outside, you know, and I was rushing to get back in because I was, you know, starting to freeze to death.
Right. So, very cold.
But, yeah, he always listens to the show. He's listened to us for a long time.
Yeah, it was great to
big
run
dude.
In.
Big dude. Big guy. Big guy.
Yeah. It's great to run into some of our listeners there. It was fun. Fun day. Okay. Let's get back to National Biodiesel Day.
Oh, yes, please.
I didn't
want to miss this one.
I know. It's pretty important. Rudolf Diesel invented the diesel engine. You know that? It was named after a guy named Rudolf Diesel.
Wow.
He invented the diesel engine.
Lucky he had that name, I guess.
He unveiled it at the World's Fair back in 1900.
Yeah.
I remember it like it was yesterday.
Do you remember Diesel 10?
Who?
Diesel 10?
No. Is that a cartoon?
What is that?
That's a train in the Thomas, the tank.
Oh.
Tank. Yeah.
Okay. All right.
Yeah, like
I was a big fan of Thomas the Train when I was a kid.
Yeah. The diesel engine was originally designed to run on peanut oil. And Rudolf Diesel was a big believer in the role of the plant that plant oils could play in fueling America. I guess that really didn't get very far, but
kind of like the biodiesel stuff.
Yeah.
Wow.
So, all right.
You heard of people who can like run their diesel cars on like old fryer oil?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. I always get a kick out of that. It's really funny. You just pull up to a McDonald's and fill up your car.
You know, back in the old days, about in the 60s, I used to collect and cut out of the newspaper articles about the end of the gasoline engine and the alternatives they have come up with. And I just kept collecting them. You know, none of that stuff ever happened. Either they were bought out by the fossil fuel industry.
Yeah, to put them out of business.
Or they were killed.
Yeah. That's what happened back in the old days. Yeah. It's National Sloppy Joe Day. Hey, we all love Sloppy Joes, don't we? Yes, it's one of America's all-time favorite hot sandwiches. Its base ingredients, of course, is often ground beef. However, you can use turkey or buffalo meat. Other elements give it some flavor, though. Onions, tomato sauce, brown sugar. Oh, boy.
I forgot he did a Sloppy Joe song.
Yeah. It's good stuff.
Yeah. Who's that again?
This is Adam Sandler.
Yeah,
Lunch Lady Land.
Yeah. Okay, that's enough about the Sloppy Joe. We don't really care.
I wanted to ask you about diesel.
Oh, back to
now,
diesel
I say
thing?
Diesel. A lot of people say diesel.
Diesel.
I say diesel.
Yeah, I say diesel too.
Like
diesel.
A Z sound.
Yeah, I think that's correct.
Yeah.
Yeah.
All right.
Maybe you should ask Frenchie how to...
Well, I'd love to ask Frenchie that.
In the meantime, we'll find out about National Lacey Oatmeal Cookie Day. Lacey Oatmeal Cookie. Have you ever even heard of Lacey Oatmeal Cookies?
I see a picture of on your laptop there, and it's ridiculous. No, no one has ever put icing on a cookie looking like that.
Here's the rundown on this.
This is ridiculous.
Some people may refer to this day as National Oatmeal Cookie Day.
There you go.
But it's really National Lacey Oatmeal Cookie Day. I don't know what the difference is, but it says here. The difference between the two is that Lacey Oatmeal Cookies are wafer thin and typically accompany a scoop of ice cream.
Yuck. Man.
In the early 1900s, oatmeal became a major ingredient in the American diet.
Does anybody like wafer thin cookies? No one does. No one likes that
they're
stuff.
Hard on your teeth.
Yeah. You know, and they're crunchy. You might as well just eat a cracker or something.
Right.
It's not good.
Okay. Do we have any more? Oh, it's National Awkward Moments Day. Boy, this is a day just for us.
So far, it's been like that.
Awkward every single moment. This is an annual day every person can relate to. It says we've all had awkward moments from time to time. That's just part of life. But who writes this stuff? Have you ever called someone by the wrong name, tripped over something, walked into a door, had a completely wrong words come out of your mouth, or just forgotten what you were doing? All those things happened to me yesterday afternoon at High Noon Saloon. The list could go on and on.
Yeah.
But sometimes, okay, it's National Awkward Moments Day, so, you know, do something awkward today.
Yeah, yes, give us a call, make us feel awkward.
Okay, and it's Supreme Sacrifice, just a minute left here. Yes, Supreme Sacrifice Day.
Giving you the finger.
Yeah. Oh, is that what he was doing? Okay, sorry, Sam. National Supreme Sacrifice Day. It's not coming up. Okay. Here we go.
Oh, there it is.
It continues to research the origins of this day. It's been observed since at least 2004. Okay, it doesn't really talk about supreme sacrifice except to salute firefighters and patriots. Okay. All right. 18 minutes past the hour.
I feel smarter now.
Good, good. It's the John and Gordy Show for a Monday morning on Mad Radio 92.7 WMDX. Coming up, realtors losing 6%.
Yeah, that's bad. WMDX, 92.7 FM and 1580 AM in the great city of Madison.
John, before we go too far, I don't know if you've noticed our new effect that we have on our Facebook page and YouTube page and everything that you can see us visually on Twitter X. We got a strobe light going this morning.
We do.
On our Mad Radio sign right
that
behind
us. That is fantastic.
Now, Sam worked all night long to set this up. I think it's quite effective.
It's actually me just sitting here flicking a switch constantly.
Is that how it works?
Yep. I'm just on, off, on, well, off, on, off, off.
Let me say, it's not distracting.
Kind of interesting.
How
it's
wonderful.
On the blue sign behind us, and it looks neat, doesn't it?
It does kind of look cool, actually. We should just leave it.
It's a dying fluorescent light.
Right. Right above that sign.
Yeah.
That's cool. All right.
Well, one day we'll have...
I'm distracted.
Yeah. We'll have LED lights in here. And we'll have done away with all the fluorescent.
I spent a whole summer replacing fluorescent lights once.
Yeah?
Where?
At a really big YMCA. That's where I worked. And, whenever we didn't have anything else to do, I worked with the facilities guy. We just went and changed light bulbs all day long.
Did you change the little converter boxes that they have in any?
No, they didn't switch over to LED yet. They were still old style fluorescent with ballasts,
Okay.
Yeah. All right, let's get into something that I was very familiar with for many years. I'm sure a few other people at the station are still in real estate, I understand. But, But having been in there for about 14 years, purchased my house. as a realtor.
Yeah.
There was a 6% commission. Normally standard procedure, 6%.
Sure.
You couldn't negotiate. You didn't allow anything lower. The brokers of each and every real estate firm insisted on 6%. They tried to keep you and toe the line at 6%. And standard. Sometimes, you know, you'd be out there, you'd be speaking to the person trying to sell their home, and they need a little extra cash out of it, and they'd try to negotiate down to 5% or 4% or something like that, or even negotiate with the buyer and try to reduce the commission that way. But they wouldn't let that happen. And, well, there was a lawsuit, and it turned out that they were preventing competition in regards to the commission being charged, the seller or the buyer in many cases, because there are buyer's agents now. So anyway, they're liable for $1.8 billion in damages. And this is out of Missouri.
Wow.
Yeah, it's a big court decision. It's the end of this 6% solid commission out there. You could still, you know, charge 6%, but it's not going to be forced on you by any of the real estate brokerages out there.
How do they police this? I mean, who's the controlling authority on that? I mean,
well, it's usually the like we have the Wisconsin Realtors Association.
Okay.
And they make sure that you toe the line.
All right.
They're very right wing, by the way.
Okay. Oh, really?
And, yes. Oh, I had many conversations with the with the head guy.
Yeah.
At the Realtors Association. I doubt he's there anymore, but I did not like anything that they did and what they espoused, according to, you know, the legislature and the laws that the Realtors Association had been pushed.
Mm-hmm.
Or pushing on the legislature to pass.
Okay.
They got rid of a lot of safety conditions for building codes. Yes.
Okay.
Oh, it's too costly for the developers. Sorry about that, but you know, maybe it comes in handy preventing fires or saving lives,
right.
Getting electrocuted.
Uh-huh. Yeah, important anyway, things like yeah. So the 6% commission is going away.
It is.
Like immediately? How does this work? Are they going to phase this in?
I don't know how that's going to phase in or not. I would assume that it's immediate. No one wants to be on the wrong side of this law at
so
this point.
It's going to make things a little more competitive then.
Yeah. You'll be able to negotiate now. Thank goodness, right?
Well, yeah.
It gives the buyers and sellers a little bit more money, a little more cash to walk away with.
Okay.
And I always believed in that. I thought, you know, it's something that you should be able to negotiate. It shouldn't be a hard 6%.
Uh-huh.
In other words, the seller is charged 3% of the sale price, and the buyer pays 3%. So it's pretty extreme, I think. That's a lot of money.
Well, yeah.
Especially when you're talking about McMansions that are being sold out there in the suburbs.
So to the does the buyer's agent and the seller's agent end up doing this negotiation about the what the commissions are going to be, or is it really the buyers
and sellers? Sometimes that happens, yeah. Okay. You know, if the buyer doesn't have a lot of money, they try to negotiate the commission down from where it was.
Sure.
Now it's going to be very competitive.
Okay.
It'll be interesting to see how that goes. A lot of people would sell their homes by themselves, so for sale by owner. FSBO, they used to call them.
Okay.
But now,
you
know,
with
this.
A band called FSBO a long time ago. Yeah. Great band. Played polkas and punk rock.
Oh.
It's good stuff.
Well, it's a good name.
Yeah, FSBO.
For a polka band.
Yeah, thanks.
I like that.
Well, that's good. I'm glad. You know what? You said you were a real estate agent for 14 years.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
I really.
Why'd you get out of it?
I enjoyed it.
But
I was there in the crossover, the time where, you know, you could provide all this information to the buyers and the sellers.
Okay.
And then all of a sudden, the internet happened. The series of tubes. It's not a big dump truck where you dump all this information in it. It's a series of tubes. And
the internet is a series of tubes.
There you go.
Okay.
And when that came in.
Yeah.
Everybody could access their own information, and they brought their own information to the table, and they felt like they didn't need realtors anymore.
Uh-huh.
Some people call it realtors.
No, I
hate that.
I know. My dad was a realtor. And
he hated,
you know,
that, too?
You all do.
Realtor.
Because everybody mispronounces it. It's a realtor.
Yeah. That's right.
Yeah. Not realtor.
But yeah. Anyway, yes, there was that transition and everybody thought they could be their own realtor. And right. A lot of them could.
Yeah.
There were a lot of information out there. They came to the table loaded for bear. They knew what they were talking about. They could negotiate. They could do everything.
Yeah.
So it was a nice transition, and I appreciated it, but I didn't appreciate being looked on as some kind of con artist, somebody who you couldn't trust.
You really know, you have to know real estate law. I mean, it's really more of a legal thing.
Well, being a realtor is the practice of looking like you're a lawyer, but you can't be a lawyer.
Okay.
They have very definite rules on that. By filling out paperwork, they give you... Attorneys have said you can only fill out the paperwork this way, that way, because then you're being an attorney, and we're stepping on their toes. So they were very, very adamant about just making sure we're filling in the blanks. We're not giving legal advice.
Okay. Right? Well, good.
But, yeah, those are good questions, Gordy.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
I was wondering
about your years of real estate, because I was living in Indiana and doing something completely different. So I thought, I wonder what John Peterson's doing.
I had a real estate radio show.
Did you really? I didn't know that. Where was that?
That was in the early 2000s.
Okay.
Nice. I gave people consumer advice.
Wow. Maybe you should do that here. You could do a little show here.
A little real estate thing?
Yeah, why not?
No, not a weekend show. I'll do it. I'll add it to this show.
Okay, all right.
One of my most favorite things that you've ever said on this show is when you first showed up to broadcasting school, your instructor was like, God, I'd wish I'd gotten into real estate.
Yeah, and that stuck with you all those years.
Yes, it did. It did. And I tried it, and it worked.
Okay. 29 past the hour. Coming up. Oh, boy. North Carolina MAGAs are going to get a state school superintendent in place.
Oh, man.
Up in the morning and out to school. The teacher is teaching the golden rule. American history and practical math. You study them hard and hoping to pass. Working your fingers right down to the bone. The guy behind you won't leave you alone.
Ah, yes, the old days at school.
Yes.
Yeah.
We got a school
story. We got away with a lot.
I think so, yeah. Mav Radio 92.7 WMDX, John and Gordy. And
Chuck
Monday
Berry
morning.
Talking about what we did get away with way back when in the school days.
Right. Yeah.
Well, anyway, there's a lot of weird stuff happening at school. We'll talk about that in just a moment. But first, a guy we haven't heard from for a while now, and it's the mean farmer.
Oh, boy.
Oh, you know.
Oh.
You know. So let's find out about what he's into now. The Ben Franklins.
Okay.
Huh? This is the Mean Farmer, and this week on the Mean Farmer Show, drink plenty of liquids and remember Ben Franklin. Yeah, it's healthy to drink plenty of liquids. Let me tell you a little story that illustrates that point. Now, last year, my cousin from the big city came to visit. He's a lawyer from L.A., showbiz lawyer, a mean lawyer. Oh, you know he's mean. Why, he's so mean, once he fell off his yacht into the Pacific Ocean, sharks were swimming around everywhere, but they didn't eat him. Nope. Professional courtesy. I love an old joke. What a chestnut. Anyways, he came over and tried to talk me into selling out to some Japanese company that made a zillion trillion yens or hens or something, selling talking bathroom scales in Manchuria and Southern California. Now, I'll sell out. Oh, yeah. I'll sell out as soon as my nose grows feathers and I sprout a butterball pop up when I'm done thermometer on my chest. But I want to be polite. You know I do. So I keep rhyming Mr. Big City with his favorite imported beer, bottle after bottle of Yuppie Brew. I just drive him around on the Massey Ferguson, showing him the farm his foreign masters will never get their hands on. Have another brewski, I say. How about a pitcher of iced tea? Here, cap that off with a can of Diet Pop. Finally, he hears the call. It's Mother Nature.
It's time,
she says.
It's time.
Since he's been jabbering so much, actually, it's way past time. He says, let's go back to the house. I hear Mother Nature calling. I just laugh. Hey. Just go on over there on that bush, I say. Just go on that bush next to the fence. And so he does. Seconds later, he remembers Ben Franklin. Remember I mentioned him at the beginning of the show? Have you forgotten? Well, that big city boy remembers Ben Franklin. That fence by the bush? It's electrified. Talk about a lawyer's briefs. Woo! Smoking. And next week on the Mean Farmer Show, wash your hands before returning to work. And brush off your backside, too.
Oh, yeah. Never know what the mean farmers come up with next.
You know. He knows.
Okay.
Oh, man. Yeah.
Wow.
Wow. You know, I had that similar. Yeah, my cousin, they had an electrified fence around their property. I didn't know anything about electrified fences. I'm a city boy, right?
Right, yeah.
And my cousin, a girl, thought she'd have some fun by just having me touch the fence. You know?
Just dared you to touch it?
Touch it, you know?
See what happens?
Yeah. Just go under the fence, you know? So I grabbed the wire, and boy, I was...
Get a little zap.
I was a little surprised.
Yeah?
Yeah. But
were you able to let go? Because sometimes you get stuck onto it.
It wasn't super electrified, but it really provided a little buzz.
Enough to send a message.
It did send a message.
Don't ever do this again.
Boy, that was real nice of her.
Yeah. You still talk to that cousin? Is she still around?
No, I don't talk to her. You know what? She stopped talking to us.
Okay.
She's out in California someplace. She doesn't want to have anything to do with this family.
No kidding.
Yeah.
Oh, that's sad.
Well, you know, Norwegians are kind of like that.
Moody?
Yeah, they're just distant.
Very moody.
They're very distant,
moody
cold
Norwegians.
People.
Okay.
Oh, the Lutherans. All right, let's talk about...
By the way, John, before you go too far here, don't forget, we're going to be at Short Stack Eatery this coming Wednesday, like we are every Wednesday. From 6 to 8 a.m. with the show. It's at 301 West Johnson Street.
Alex and Sinead.
Yeah, they're right down the street here, and we invite you to join us. That's at Short Stack Eatery this Wednesday, 6 to 8 a.m. Okay?
All right. Well, that's fantastic. I believe that we're going to help them cook one of these times.
Yep, we're going to be behind the grill there.
Pulling out the kitchen lingo.
Yep, that's right. That's what we're going to do.
Again, we're going to try and help them.
They don't know that yet, but now they know.
We're going to try to help them out.
Yeah.
Okay. All right, let's get to what's going on in North Carolina, the crazy place, North Carolina. Who knows what happened there? They got something in the water. I mean, the governor is an extreme racist, bigot, and...
Now they're going to get a new school superintendent?
Yeah. The GOP nominee to run the North Carolina Public Schools has called for violence against Democrats, including executing Obama and Biden. And that's just the start. That's the beginning of what she wants to do.
That's the GOP nominee for this.
Yes.
It's
crazy. What is going on out there? It wasn't this extreme at one time. At least the candidates weren't this extreme. Now they are. Of course, CNN reached out to the candidate for school superintendent out there and her campaign multiple times, but they did not get a response from them. And following publication of this story, this candidate for superintendent defended her previous tweets, claiming Obama committed treason. She said, and she, by the way, this candidate is a registered nurse. Nice to have this as a registered nurse who wants to kill people and execute them. What a nurse.
Proactive.
Yes. And she's a grassroots activist and homeschooled her kids, so she wants to handle, you know, public schools.
Okay.
Anyway, she ran on a platform of supporting parental rights and opposing critical race theory, which isn't an issue in schools. They don't teach critical race theory, but then you know that they're a little crazy and over the top. She has, in the past, called public schools socialism centers and indoctrination centers as well. And I've got a little coverage here in regards to Michelle Morrow, the candidate for the North Carolina school superintendent. Let's check that out as cut 515.
All right.
Which brings us to the Republican nominee to run North Carolina schools, who has tweeted about putting Democrats to death. Her name is Michelle Morrow. Here's one of her tweets. Take a look. It's a doctored photo of former President Barack Obama in an electric chair. Morrow wrote, "Death to all traitors, hashtag Obamagate." Again, this is the Republican nominee to oversee public schools in North Carolina, you know, home of the research triangle.
Well, that's right, Jake. Last week, Morrow, a conservative activist, won the nomination, upsetting the incumbent North Carolina school superintendent. That's the state's top school job while she was calling schools indoctrination centers and socialism centers. She's also been linked to the QAnon conspiracy theories, sharing a slogan associated with QAnon, "Where we go one, we go all," at least 7 times on Twitter. She's also promoted the baseless adrenochrome conspiracy, which claims that celebrities harvest the blood of children. And she has also made extreme anti-Muslim comments. All of this while repeatedly talking about executing prominent Democrats. Take a look at this tweet of 2020 where she's responding to someone who says they want to see Obama tossed in Gitmo. Mauro wrote, quote, "I prefer a pay-per-view of him in front of the firing squad. I do not want to waste another dime on supporting his life. We could make some money back from televising his death." In another tweet from December 2020, Mauro suggested executing Joe Biden, who was then president-elect, because he had asked Americans to wear a mask for 100 days at the height of the COVID-19 pandemic, saying, quote, we need to follow the Constitution's advice, and then in all caps, kill all traitors. And even expressed belief in a very bizarre conspiracy theory that Chinese troops were going to invade the United States to help Joe Biden be sworn in as president. There's a tweet, tens of thousands of Chinese soldiers are already in Canada and probably Mexico waiting for orders to invade. Now, if Mauro wins and becomes the superintendent of North Carolina schools, she's going to have oversight of an $11 billion budget. And of course, education for the state's 1.3 million K through 12 students.
Unbelievable.
Mark Robinson, who's at the top of the ticket, as you mentioned, has that history of extremely controversial comments. And this was a state that Trump beat Biden by in 2020 with his smallest margin.
Wow. So,
There's a lot there.
So I don't see any MAGAs trying to protect their children from this individual at this point. They're trying to elect her?
Yeah.
No, you want to keep this one away. Yeah. No, you don't want her near kids.
North Carolina.
You don't want them around.
Yeah.
Wow.
Michelle Morrow. Okay, we'll keep an eye on her campaign there.
The coverage of this thing is a little unusual because they have not talked about any kind of other competitor in this race.
Right.
She beat out the incumbent, sure, in a primary, but what about the other person?
Yeah.
Is it a Democrat? Is it a political position in the first place, or is it non-political?
We'll have to do some digging on that.
But they didn't cover any of that.
No.
those people don't matter. It's this crazy nut job in North Carolina running for superintendent of the state schools.
Yeah.
Now, she's not a danger to the kids.
Yeah, that's what gets the coverage.
And it should. I mean, we should avoid people like this.
Well, yeah.
Maybe we should lock people up like this. Lock them up.
Okay.
Let's repeat what they're doing. No, that's not going to happen.
But the thing is, she was a registered nurse and a grassroots activist and homeschooled her kids.
Homeschooling.
Yeah.
She believes in homeschooling enough to teach her kids at school. And then now she's going to try and control the public schools for whatever reason. Mm. Maybe she's changed her mind. Maybe she thinks public schools are really good for kids.
Yeah. Again, we'll keep tracking it.
Maybe she wants to destroy it from the inside. What do you think?
It's North Carolina. Anything goes.
Yeah. As long as it's
beautiful
not
country
Wisconsin.
Down there, by the way.
Is it really?
It's gorgeous. Yeah.
So why do they act like this,
I don't know. Look, they're out there in the state. They don't have the internet, I don't think. Yeah. Some places there. I don't know. I know I've driven through there, and it's beautiful. That's all I know.
Well, that's good. Yeah. You know, I've gone through states in the South that I would not want to drive through again.
Where was the place that you were driving your Carmen Ghia? Well, that was in Texas.
Oh, that was in Texas, the Panhandle.
Yeah. Yeah.
What's the worst state that you've been to?
Oh, Lord.
Well, Indiana's close.
I spent a lot of time there, but I think it'd be a toss-up between Mississippi and Alabama. I think it's pretty pretty bleak there.
Mississippi is a bad state to drive through.
Oh boy. Man. Again, beautiful country, but yeah, it's a different world.
It really is. Yeah. Man.
Yeah.
Although Louisiana was kind of interesting.
Yeah. Well, they got New Orleans.
Yeah.
That's cool.
A number of years ago, my family went on a trip for spring break, like all four of us, and we went to Kentucky, and that was probably my most hated state.
Wow.
But when I was there, I noticed a trend. Whenever we would drive through all these little small towns in Kentucky, we noticed a pattern on like the main streets of these towns. We would see a liquor store. Yeah. And then a strip club, and then a church, and then this pattern would repeat.
Wow. I like that pattern.
Yeah, that's good. That's good. They got it covered. Lots of horses down there, too, in Kentucky. Lots of horse ranches.
We've got a story on porn coming up later on in the South.
That's nice.
And it's predominantly where porn is watched. Mm. The South is big on porn.
Is that right?
And Texas is having some problems with porn at this point.
All right.
And we'll get to that story a little bit later on because it's wild.
Stay tuned.
It's crazy stuff. But it tells you a lot about Christian nationalism.
Mm-hmm. Okay. A little bit later in our next hour, we're going to be finding out about street vending here in Madison. We're going to talk to Megan Blakehorst. She's our special guest in our next hour, talking about, street vendors.
Oh, you know.
I think you do.
Oh, you know.
They got a night market coming up. They got all kinds of things going on. And we'll be talking to Megan Blakehorst a little bit later on in the show.
Okay, we'll find out. You know, a lot of people have the munchies after they get out of the bars, and they want something to eat.
That's right.
So it's going to happen.
Speaking of munchies, we got a pot story coming up. Oh, boy.
Yes, we do.
Oh, wait till you hear this.
Oh, you know. Oh, you know.
Yeah, baby. Who is that? Is that Neil Diamond?
Of course it is.
Didn't know he did a pot song.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. It was kind of an anti-pot.
Turn it back thing. Up there, Sarah. No?
You it's an anti-pot right. thing.
Okay.
And in between, he'd have interviews with people, you know, telling their stories about turning on to pot and then going on to something heavier and more effective.
Seriously?
Yeah, it was an anti-drug thing that he did. But but I like the tune.
Was he friends with Joe Friday?
Yeah, maybe.
We'll find out.
All right.
A little bit later on. We have a little track from Joe Friday again. We love Joe Friday.
He's great.
There's nothing like him. Nothing. He's so sure of himself. Anyway, let's get to this pot story. For the first time in Gallup polling history, more Americans, get this.
Yeah.
Now, here in this state, the Republicans will not approve recreational pot. It's a bad thing. It's a horrible thing. It's a federal drug that no one should approve of.
Right.
And now guess what? More Americans, 16%, say they smoke marijuana than the 11% who smoke cigarettes.
Wow.
So more people are smoking pot than they are cigarettes.
Okay.
But we can't have legalized pot in this state. But we can certainly have something that causes cancer like cigarettes.
Mm. That is quite a figure.
Yeah.
So 16% they smoked marijuana in the last week,
yep.
And 11% tobacco cigarettes.
Yeah.
Huh.
So more people smoke pot now.
Okay.
Than cigarettes. I think that's a great reversal.
Well,
what can you do?
Especially since it's legal in about 25 states? It's about
something
half
like
and half,
that, yeah.
28.
And more states are coming online, especially in November.
Mm-hmm.
They have their approval, recreational pot approval legislation on the ballot. So we'll see what happens there. The Gallup poll from 2022 now, a couple of years behind, found that 4% of Americans admitted that they had even tried marijuana, let alone smoked it regularly. Today, 48% of Americans say they have at least tried it.
That's a huge jump in that number.
It is. It's huge. And by the way, a recorded high percentage of Americans, over two-thirds per Gallup, say they favor legalization of recreational marijuana.
Wow.
That's two-thirds
yeah.
that our Republicans in this state won't listen to, don't care about. They're going to stick to the idea that pot is something that we should avoid. It's a reefer madness that they have.
Gateway drug.
Wow. Ballot measures to legalize recreational marijuana have passed in blue states, New Jersey, purple states, Arizona, and red states, Montana, in recent years. And this year, we shouldn't be amazed if it passes in other blue states and red states like Maryland and even South Dakota. Again, this would be shocking if you had said so about 50 years ago. What happened 50 years ago? Well, let's find out.
I don't have the Joe Friday cut that you're looking for, but
what?
We'll hear.
What do you mean you don't have it?
It seems to be missing, but we've got one of his other rants on it here.
All right.
Marijuana is the flame. Heroin is the fuse. LSD is the bomb. So don't you try to equate liquor with marijuana, mister. Not with me. You may sell that jazz to another pothead, but not to somebody who spends most of their time holding some sick kid's head while he vomits and retches sitting on a curbstone at 4 o'clock in the morning.
Oh, that's
and when his knees get enough starch back in him so he can stand up and empty his pockets, you can bet he'll turn out a stick or two of marijuana. And you can double your money. He'll be holding a sugar cube or a cap or two. So don't you con me with your mind expansion slop. I deal with kids every day. I try to clean up the mess that people like you make out of them. I'm the expert here. You're not.
No, I don't know how much of an expert he is. A little behind the times there, Mr. Friday.
Yeah.
Mr. Friday.
Okay.
Oh, God. Well, you know what? I do want to get that debate in there. We haven't found that any place at all?
I'll take a look for it. I'll see if I can find
it. All right. Just put it in the search bar up there in the page, and you'll come up with it, I'm sure.
Okay.
Somewhere.
We'll work on it.
All right. We'll check that out. All right.
A little pause for the cause here. Just take a deep breath.
Are you guys waiting on me? Jeez, the pressure's on now.
It's a minute. It's a meditation minute. It's the new John and Gordy meditation minute.
All right.
A moment of silence to just, clear our heads of, anything else, and then we move on.
Yeah, I thought the story was a little moving, so maybe we should,
We've got it here. We've got why you shouldn't be smoking marijuana.
Okay, well, let's go with that.
This is the debate.
Okay.
Have you been smoking marijuana?
Marijuana is illegal, I know that.
That's right.
For now. In a couple of years, things may change when all the kids grow up and start wearing ties and going to the polls. Marijuana is going to be like liquor, packaged and taxed and sold right off the shelf.
I doubt it, Mr. Shipley.
Look, I don't mean to be disrespectful, but it seems to me there must be better things for cops to do than chase down wild rumors about something as innocent as marijuana. Why don't you go after the big bad guys, the heroin peddlers? I won't argue with you about them. They should be stopped.
That's right. We'd like to put them out of business. That's why we're here.
What do you mean?
We're trying to keep them from getting a new customer.
There's a big difference between marijuana and hard narcotics.
Yeah, but it's only a small step.
Ooh, and everybody who takes a drink is going to be an alcoholic. We know that's not true, don't we?
Let's
face it, we're on opposite sides of the fence, and there's nothing we can do about it. For you, if there's a law against it, it's wrong, black and white. I just don't see things that way, that's all.
Well, you ought to give it a try, fella. It might keep you out of jail.
Maybe. But we'll change the law someday, even though your friend here thinks we won't. Believe me, it's a new world. Your laws are as outdated as bustles. Laws are going to have to be changed to keep pace with the new morality. They'll change or we'll have to break them.
What about your daughter? How's she going to feel if you end up in jail?
She won't like it any more than I will, but you'll have to catch me before you can arrest me, won't you? In the meantime, it's a big game of hide-and-seek, and to me, it is a waste of time.
How old are you, Shipley?
23.
Isn't about time you grew up?
Here we go. Lecture number 131A.
No, I'm not going to give you a lecture. I don't have the time. I'm just going to lay it out for you straight. Now, you listen to me.
Here's the
lecture. You chippy around with marijuana long enough, and you're going to buy yourself a lot of grief. After a while, marijuana won't be enough. You'll start looking for a bigger kick, and then a bigger one after that. And all of this is going to go down the tubes. Your job, your house, car, family, everything. We've seen it happen before, and not just to the neurotics and psychotics that wife of yours talks about, but to nice, clean-cut kids from good families with good educations. They start out just like you, and they end up mainliners, shooting it in their arms. And they end up dead, or wishing they were.
Okay.
That was
the bottom line.
That really...
Joe Friday.
Now, I'm convinced, we should really make marijuana illegal again.
Roll it all back.
Yeah. He convinced me.
Yeah. Well, he'd be right in line with Eric Hovde then, he wants to just make it illegal. And alcohol, too. He'd... Take that.
That's right.
Take that down.
Obviously, doesn't want us to have alcohol. If you want alcohol, you should brew it yourself.
That's it.
Wow.
Okay.
I don't think anybody has ever proposed something as ridiculous as that.
Yeah. Well, that's not on this year's platform.
I used to brew beer.
Did you?
Yeah.
What happened?
Yeah.
How come you don't do that anymore? Oh, I remember in the old days, you used to brew it all the time.
Something happened to contaminate my beer all the time, every time. After a while, I just gave it up. I couldn't clean out all the equipment enough to stop that from happening. But Hovde, maybe he's got a plan where we can brew our own stuff finally in clean containers.
Very good. 6:58, we've got news and sports and weather. And in our next hour, Megan Blakehorse from the city talking about vending.